Bueno, gracias María. Íbamos muy bien de tiempo, pero María se lo ha gastado todo. O sea que al resto sí que os pido por favor que intentéis ajustar a los 5 o 6 minutillos, ¿vale? Pero gracias de todos modos. Bueno, nuestro siguiente ponente es Dario Berciu. Él es físico, su especialidad es la física de materia condensada y viene desde el DIPC, de Donostia International Physics Center. Y creo que nos va a hablar algo así como de las ondas en el mundo cuántico, me parece. Os dejo con él.
So, good morning, everybody. I'm the first one speaking in English. I'll try to go slow so that I don't lose anybody of you. So, I'm not going to talk about the waves because I decided to tell you a little bit about what is my work and why I'm doing what I'm doing. So, this is not what I'm actually doing. Well, when I was 8 years old in school, the teacher told us that matter can be solid or can be like water, liquid, or can be vapor. And the funny is that in this picture here, you have all three phases at the same time. So we have solid, the ice, we have water, the liquid, and then we have the clouds, so the vapor. But then I was curious as a kid, so I asked the teacher, well, I'm fine with those three things, but what is fire? Do you know what is fire? Is fire one of the three things we said before? It's something else. It's energy that is exchanged when we go from one form to another. So my interest for matter in the three forms we have seen before is still there, but instead of looking at matter to the size of our body, so meter to meters or longer, I'm interested in matter in smaller scale. So put a hand in your head. So touch your hair. So how big is one hair? So if you look at this scale, it's 80 micrometers. So a micron is 1 millionth times smaller than a meter. So it means that one hair has a diameter of 80 micrometers. So one micrometer is 1,000 times smaller than a millimeter. So try to imagine how small is one hair. But for what I'm studying, 80 micrometers is still too large. So actually I'm interested in this Windows blue here, where you go from 10 to the minus 7 meter to 10 to the minus 9 meter, that is nanometers. And why am I interested to these windows? Because if we go to this scale from 1 meter to 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 6 meters, more or less we can use the law of classical physics, that is more or less what you study now in school, how objects are moving. But when you go down to this scale and you cool down the temperature of the object a lot, new laws comes up that are the laws of quantum physics. And here is where I'm investigating, because here you have new materials with new properties that we can use for future technology for your smartphone or things like this. So here is where I'm doing my investigation. But what is actually how my daily life looks like? So you know, this is myself, you see? So you do some reading, you read some book, some work by someone else, you think, and then you get some idea. Then you put down the piece of paper, you start to write down a lot of calculations, and eventually you do a very nice figure, and then you write an article, and you send an article to a journal for publication to let to the other people to know about your results. But my daily activity can be different. Some colleague can call me and can tell me, look, I've done a wonderful experiment with potato. And I found those results here by changing this parameter. That is, for example, is the temperature of the oil where you fry the potato. And then you say, and then the colleague is telling you, can we explain together those curve? You sit down, you do some theory, you come up with some result, and then you are able to do a kind of red line that go through all these blue points. And then with this colleague, you sit down, you write an article, and you send to a journal for publication. Let me stress something really important about this plot here. You see that each point has a bar. This is important because science, physical science is an exact science. So it means that when you go to the lab, you don't do an experiment one time and you are happy. You do an experiment one, two, three, many times, so that you can estimate the error that you have when you do a measurement. This is important because when you go to a colleague, you say, oh, this potato measured 3 meters. You don't tell him 3 meters and that's all. You tell him, 3 meters plus minus 3 centimeters. So you give an estimation of the error in your measurements. And this is really important. So all the people that are blaming science or the vaccine or whatsoever, they forget that we do a lot of control to be sure that what we are saying is correct. So this led me to one slide more. So when you were outside, you have seen that there is Einstein that is sitting on a bench. So everybody, when we think to a physicist, we think about Einstein or the other genius. But it's important to know that this work is difficult, but it's a community work. So you don't do all your work by yourself. So again, you work with colleagues that are doing experiments or also with other colleagues that are doing theory. And then you work with them to write some theory or some experimental paper. But the teamwork does not stop here. You write an article, and then you send this article to a journal, and then there is someone else, like example myself or some other colleague that is sitting in this room, that is taking your article, is reading, and is trying to understand if it's correct or not according to the law that we are following. So there is a teamwork before of writing an article, and there is also a sort of teamwork after that you have written an article. And the last thing that I love about my work is that I can travel a lot. I can visit a lot of new places, and I can get to know people from many, many more countries. And you heard that my surname is actually French, but I'm not French. I'm actually Italian. I'm coming from Naples. Probably you heard about Naples, the place where you can eat the best pizza in the world. So I studied here, and then during my studies, I moved in Pisa, where it is the famous Bandit Tower. And when I finished with my PhD, I moved to Germany, and I was at the first in a beautiful medieval town that is called Ratisbona, Regensburg in German. Then I moved to another place that is called Freiburg. In Spanish is Friburgo. It's famous because it's to the beginning of the Black Forest, la Selva Negra. Then I lived 1 year in Berlin. And then a few years ago, I moved to the Basque Country. Sorry, this is an emoticon that came out really bad. Well, the meaning of this emoticon is that I moved here with my wife, and now here we have established our family. So, but the message here is that you travel a lot, and I'm really proud because my passport is saying that I'm from the European Union and Repubblica Italiana, so the Italian Republic. But I'm proud that after so many traveling within Europe, I'm happy to consider myself a first generation of truly European person. And I really want to say you that science is a beautiful trip, and if you can, try to do it. Thank you.